Present.
Thea Garza, absent. Denise Wellington, absent. Jay Rosenbaum, absent. Guillermo Gomez. Joe Truhart. Lucy Vandenberg, absent. Jason Reyes. We do not have a quorum. Good evening. Tonight, Principal Hope Grant and Vice Principal Melissa Wyatt are proud to present, as part of the Trenton Chambers High School Visual and Performing Arts Small Learning Community, their dance and drama departments. Under the direction of Ms. Christina Forche, Trenton Chambers High School Theater students, Maria Solis and Diana Rodriguez will reprise their roles as Mom and Fudge from Tales of a Fourth Grade. Jeffrey Petaway will give the introduction of a Drama 2 class and will perform his award-winning audition. Naomi Watson and Brianna Martinez will highlight the current projects of the Drama 1 class and perform an original pantomime. The Trenton Chambers Dance Department, under the guidance of Elizabeth Sirwinski, will present a modern dance piece entitled Departures. The Trenton Chambers student dancers that you see tonight performed their piece earlier this month at the New Jersey High School Dance Festival and received a high score for their technique, artistry, and choreography. We welcome the Dance Department.
Drama 2 class. We're just today in the class of Drama 2. We learned
learned about like stage presence, monologues, and how to, you know, adapt around stage. And I went we had a McCarter audition. We did monologues, and it was a 3rd grade. We had professional headshots. We did active resumes for our careers, for the future. We also, last weekend, we went to New Jersey's Lesbian Festival, and 7 colleges were there to scout us and to call us back and everything. And for me, I got accepted to Shakespeare, King Henry V, and one by Alexander Thomas, the Rich Fourth. Here I go.
Once more, onto the breach, dear friends, once more. Or close the wall of our English dead in peace. There's nothing so becomes a man as modest, stillness, and humility. But when the blast of war blows through our ears, we have to imitate the action of the tiger, stiffness. Summon up the blood, disguise fair nature with hard finger brains. So let's rip the teeth and stretch the nostrils wide. Follow up every spirit in opponent's charge. Cry, oh God, for Harry, England, and St. George.
Jimmy is supposed to set an example. Jimmy, he's messing up. He's dipping and dabbing. He's selling and dealing. He's boosting and stealing. Listen, I'm gonna be honest. I'm gonna do some things. I'm gonna boost a little. I'm gonna steal a little. Hey, listen, I'll steal something from you right now. But it's just to feed my head. It's not to do you no harm. It's not malicious. Listen, I ain't never hurt nobody. I went to treatment programs and stuff like that. That stuff don't work for me. They use lingo like, he's got an obsession, a compulsion. I gotta take it a day at a time. They say I come from a dysfunctional family. That's true. See, this family of mine, matter of fact, put yourself in my position, right? You got a brother, he's an addict, a junkie. And he's been doing stuff for 17, maybe even 16, maybe even younger. And you let him stay at your house. And you leave a credit card on the table. Not nowhere, not in your wallet, not in your purse, but on the table. And he uses it for his habit. Would you call the cops on your own brother? See, dysfunctional. See, I know I'm wrong. I know I'm wrong. I am wrong. I am wrong. I am wrong. But all I'm doing is feeding my habit. And all I want to do is just be an addict. And I admit that.
It's always too late. For those who have no idea what a pantomime is,
And anytime you want to have some fun, just visit that dance class over at BPA.
Denise Millington, absent. Jane Rosenbaum. Guillermo Gomez.
Right.
Gerald Truhart.
Right.
Lucy Vandenberg. Right. Jason Redd. We have a call. D.A. Graham?
Yes.
Thea Gusset, absent. Denise Millington, absent. Jane Rosenbaum? Guillermo Gomez?
Yes.
Gerald Truhart?
Yes.
Lucy Vandenberg?
Yes.
Jason Redd?
Yes.
Motion passed.
The New Jersey Public Meetings Law is enacted to ensure the right of the public to have advance notice of and attend meetings of public bodies after any business affecting their interests is discussed or acted on. On these rules of the SAC, the Trent Board of Education has caused a notice of this meeting by publicizing the date, time, and place, therefore posted at the Central Services Building, 101 Northland Avenue, City Clerk's Office, City Hall, and the Times. Anyone who's named on the list should receive a notice. So just for those of you following on your agendas in the August, we move the public comment period immediately after the presentation from the public budget. So we'll have the budget presentation first, and then immediately following that, we will have the public participation portion of the meeting. So, Ms. Barrett, Ms. Howard.
Good evening, Board President Jason Redd, board members, and the public at large. Tonight, we are presenting the proposed 2016-17 budget. We started to have many conversations in August and have had many conversations with many people throughout the months. At this time, it has been a long, difficult, and painful process. When we started our review, we expected $10 million shortfall that impacted close to 300 positions. After some adjustments with multiple areas, we are now able to reduce the shortfall to a little over 5.9 million and 164 positions. And at the same time, we are able to maintain our sports and arts and music programs. From the very beginning, we were guided by the Trenton Public School mission. All students will graduate with a vision for their futures, motivated to learn continually, and prepared to succeed in their choice of college and career. Our three strategic goals that drove the development of the budget were to work toward continuous improvement of the academic achievement for all students by ensuring the delivery of high quality instruction through the implementation of the Common Core State Standards and the New Jersey Standards. To ensure the budget provides for the achievement of all students and that we maintain safe, healthy, and clean facilities that reflect high standards for learning while maintaining fiscal responsibility. To continue to develop professional growth and the capacity of district employees. The four superintendent priorities continue to be to increase student achievement and close the opportunity gap, to hold adults that are accountable for student success, to provide a safe, fun, and relevant learning environment, to provide students prepared for success in the workplace, post-secondary education, and a positive contribution to the community. The four superintendent core beliefs are at the forefront of our decisions and actions. These are that all students can learn when provided a quality education. Two, teachers and principals are at the core of successful schools. Three, all students achieve high standards through rigorous, challenging, and relevant learning experience. And lastly, the successful education of our students is a result of the engagement of parents, family, and the entire community. The proposed budget provides funding that is aligned to the instructional goals and it is balanced. It has been a long and painful process. Anytime you are making reductions, it impacts people, both adults and children. At this time, Ms. Jane Hammond, Business Administrator and Board Secretary, will walk you through where the funds come from and where they are expended.
Good evening, board members. As Lucy stated, I am superintendent. This has been a long road, but we're finally here. And although we are not pleased with what you'll receive today, we say there was no other option. So if you would look at our allocation of revenues, which is mandated and given to us by the state of New Jersey, you will see that under equalization aid, I would like to start there at the $191,000. Well, you see, that is how a district is funded per pupil. The state assigns a per pupil cost per elementary student, 1.4% for middle, and another 1.17% for high school students. From that, there's a weighted average for your at-risk students, your special ed students, and your ELL students. From there, they add up all the different components, and that's how you receive your equalization aid. Within that, our fair share is also calculated. And as everyone is aware, we received an additional 2% this year from the city, which is a great thing. But our fair share would be around $40 million, and we received $21 million. So we'll always be above adequacy because we're not receiving our fair share. So if we would look at our extraordinary aid, that piece is any funding over $40,000 for our students that are placed in out-of-district schools. They pay us 75%. Transportation aid is what it is. If you're remote, you can be transported, whether you're a regular ed student or special ed. If we do courtesy busing, which we do, then it's outside of the funding that we receive. So although our aid is $2.8 million, our transportation expenses are around $8 million. So there you see there's a $6 million disconnect. If you look at our special aid, our special education aid, that is one-third of our categorical aid. Now, as in, which I've been talking about for the last 3 to 4 years, our special aid and education is funded at 14.71%. That is the state average. Whether we classify students at a 20% rate, at a 19% rate, we're only going to be paid for 14.71%. So we walk in the door in a deficit, because I believe our growth rate is around 19 to 20%. So that's another $8 million. Our adjustment aid is a plus, it's a gift for us, because we were held harmless for 3 years. After the 3 years, that was supposed to go away. We're still receiving the $20 million in our base. And that is because they're saying that the former added districts, they don't want us to be under the 2%, so they paid everyone adjustment aid. If you see, they reduced $741,000, but they increased our equalization aid. So they're going to continue to reduce that, so we won't have over $1 million at the end. Our park readiness and our per pupil growth is $10 per student for devices for our students. And our professional learning community aid is for the adult program. And as you see, if you look at the allocation of all of our revenues, you'll see excess fund balance. That is any funding that's over the mandated 2%. So as long as we have excess, then as far as the state is concerned, we have too much money, because you shouldn't have excess. You have your mandated 2%, but we have $4,700,000 over our mandated 2%. But you see, it went down from, in 17, it went down to 1.5 million, which was a 24% decrease. Our maintenance reserve is what it was. We don't have it for 17, but that is deposits in our facilities to make sure our facilities are up to par. I talked about the tax levy, which is 2% more than what we received in 2016. Now, we have not received an increase in over 20 years. So to get 2% for 17 was also a gift. Our miscellaneous revenue is our E-rate. For 16, we received 2 years' worth. That's why it's $1 million there, but now it's at $660,000. Our SEMI is $631,000, which we must realize, because the state receives 65% of that funding. If we don't realize the 100% maximum amount, we will be under a corrective action plan. State revenue are already discussed, and our grants and entitlements are $41 million. Now, our grants are broken down into preschool education aid, which is $30 million for 2017, $1 million over the prior year because of carryover funding. Title I is $5 million. IDEA is $3 million. The reason why you see a reduction in the difference column is because carryover is in our 15-16. We don't know whether we'll receive carryover for 2017. Our Carl Perkins is our vocational grant. Our local grants is our safety grant, which we may receive or we may not. So we can't count on that funding unless we know it's a sure amount. And our last grant, which is our McKinney grant, for the last 10 years, we was the homeless liaison, and now they spread it out between Burlington, Atlantic City, and Mercer. So someone in Burlington County will be the liaison for the 17 school year. Okay. Now, if we look at our percentage distribution, we see excess surplus is 2%. Our tax levy is 7% of our budget. But our state aid is 77%, and our grants is 14%. So our state, we receive 77% of our funding from the state. So if you take a look at our expenditures, I'm going to point out two. Out of district students, that's $33 million off the top. Charter schools, $37 million off the top. They increased 6% from 2016. If you look at our operations and maintenance, that went down $3 million. I talked about our maintenance reserve earlier, which was the $4 million. And our school and general central administration is up 9% from the prior year. Now, that's not just central office administration. It's also our school principals, central office, and their offices. So that went up. Our benefits reduced $3 million due to workman's comp. And then our grants is what I just went over, $1 million. So if we look at the percentage of each group to our budget, our instructional, which is ESL, bilingual, special education, that's 37% of our budget. The adult program is 0.5. Out of district is 11.16%. Charter schools is almost 13%. Central office is 2%, and grants is 14%. So that's the expenditures that make up our budget. So our fixed costs are about, 80%? So really, when we receive our funding from the state, we're working with 20%? 20%, because salaries, benefits, and our other fixed costs, they're already fixed. So if you look at school base, that's 68%. Grants, 14%. Central office, 10%. And district-wide, which is our benefits, is 8% of our budget. So enrollment. If we look at our residential enrollment, it's 14,000 students. Now, in that residential enrollment, there's charter school children, choice school children, non-public. Because we're just saying charter schools are taking a chunk of our students. But choice, Hopewell is a choice school. We have Allentown. All those schools are choice schools. We have Trent Catholic. We have non-public also. So we have about 500 students that will be leaving in 16-17 school year. So we go to our actual charter school amounts. You'll see charter schools increase by themselves 14%, which is 356 students. Foundation is K through 12. They have 988 students. They increase almost 14%. International Academy of Trenton, they increase 27%. Trenton STEM. They're 9th through 11th grade in 16-17. In 17-18, they'll be 9th through 12th grade. So our numbers will also rise in 17-18 if we don't try to do something to keep our students in district. And this is just charter, as I stated earlier, not non-public or choice. I believe Lucy and I received a letter that Foundation has increased from 988 students to 1,006 students. So from that alone, that's going to go up another $200,000 just for their current enrollment. And these numbers are coming from the state, not me calculating anything. The state downloads the information and they take the money off the top. So that's what $37 million look like. Now, if we look at our per pupil costs, for 17, it decreased 2% from 17,300 to 16,919. But if we look at our classroom cost, it increased. So we were trying to make sure that we still put our investment in our students, because that increased 1%. Our support services decreased by 2.5%. Administrative costs decreased by 2.5%. Plan operations decreased by 13%. Legal costs decreased by almost 20% in 16-17. So this is something that we really watch closely to make sure that our total classroom costs always increase. We never want to see a reduction in our classroom costs. And these are our additions and reductions per bargaining unit. If we look at our confidential unit, they increased 10%. They had 4 additions and 2 reductions. TASA decreased 7%. TEA decreased about 4%. The Paris decreased almost 56%. Business and Technical decreased almost 9%. TESA decreased 33%. And our Mechanic and Laborers and Custodians did not decrease for the 16-17 school year. So as you see, it was a long road ahead of us trying to prep.
Please let them present. It's a crowded room, make sure everybody hears it. So please, everybody, give me courtesy.
A budget that started at a $12 million shortfall to a $10 million shortfall to an $8 million shortfall to a $5.9 million shortfall. So we're hoping for the 17-18 school year that we won't have a shortfall. So we won't have to stand before you again with reductions. That's our goal. Our goal is also to make sure each department look within their department to make sure they're being efficient and effective with the number of staff that they have, not just people, but also their non-salary portion of their budgets. At this time, in the appendix, we have school budget allocations for everyone to take a look at. So you can see whether the school increased or decreased. But as you see overall, our total classroom costs increased. But I wanted you to have a copy of every school budget because this is what the county receives to make sure that every student has a thorough and efficient education. We will entertain your questions at this time.
What went into the formula for decreasing for the additions? Can you talk about the additions, Jane, for confidential?
Sure. The confidential employees, they had 4 reductions, if I'm not mistaken. The 2 additions was legal counsel, in-house legal counsel, and an assistant superintendent for school support. They are the 2 additions. But we reduced the director of student support in order to bring in the assistant superintendent, which is a confidential employee.
Yes, I just wanted to just, if you guys could just speak to more on the overall process from kind of start to finish and the various stumbling blocks, challenges that you faced throughout the process to get to this point where we are now with the balanced budget that you're presenting tonight.
Well, we started in August meeting with the board. And from at that time, we took all of our 15-16 costs and rolled them over to 16-17. And at that time, we had a $12 million shortfall because we stated that we had $6 million. I mean, I think the auditors also brought it up. Our excess surplus was $6 million at the time, and we knew that was going to be a $2 million shortfall. But we had just rolled everything over with their increases to see where we were. And then after that, we looked really delve into the budget and start looking at each department. Every department took their budget and they were supposed to go back to their individual departments and make sure they looked at everything to become more efficient as far as tangible and intangible, which is your salary costs and your non-salary pieces. We then rolled it out to the principals who met with their school leadership team members. And we gave them, we didn't give them a dollar figure. And we didn't tell them what positions. We didn't give them non-negotiables. But when they came to the table, some of them we said, well, we don't think that we'll be able to have that position for the 16-17 school year. So then they made some reductions at the school level, and then we made them at the central office level. From there, we went back and took a look at our budgets again to see where we could find more relief. We looked through workers' comp after we went to a training, and you were at that training, DA, and started doing calculations to see could we get relief there, which we did. It was $1 million. We also looked at our health benefits, tier four. I believe that was another $1 million. Our prior year conferences came to about $1 million. And then we looked at any other inefficient practices that we had, positions that were vacant for over 2 years, we said we wouldn't fund, and things of that nature. So we were able to really get it down to about, say, $8 to $7 million. And I believe the last time that I presented to the board, it was in January, and I believe it was around $7 million when you looked at the information. And I stated that I knew we could find 600 and something thousand within the budget. So during that time, we had already met with the union.
If you have a conversation, you need to take it outside, please do. There's people in here who want to hear what the discussion's about. There's folks here from the media, there's folks here from the community. So if you've got something you have to say, please take it outside of the room. So these folks are here presenting what is a difficult budget, and we are trying to do our job in here, and there are folks who have shown up who here to hear it. So if you have some conversation, please take it outside. You can go out the back and come back in once that's done.
We also, which I failed to mention earlier, we met with our union partners to ask them if they have any relief to give to the district. We met with the community also. I did a budget presentation to them. Then we went back and just kept looking at the budgets, looking at every expenditure, things that we could reduce. And by the time we actually completed the budget to upload, we worked very closely with our fiscal monitor. We were at 5.9%, 5.9 million. I mean, he was shocked that we even got to $5.9 million. So it was a long road, which started in August, and it ended in February. Sleepless nights, long hours. But we're well aware that the education is state responsibility, but this is their funding formula and their definition of a thorough and efficient education. We don't decide the funding that we receive. The state decides the funding through our data that is given to them. That's why we have to make sure when we look at our data, it's cleansed before we give any information to the state, because then we are funded according to that data.
Just want to add that we also submitted the budget and did a budget review at the county. And on March 8th, we were at the county office, and for the next 2 to 3 weeks, actually not until today, we had to respond to multiple questions back and forth around how we would still support and provide services to our students.
Ms. Howard, can you talk to the amount that they looked last year you budgeted for, and how that differed from the amount that we ultimately received towards students? Like, my question is, how are we able to plan for next year? Like we plan for this year. It seems like every time we finish our budget, we put a budget in the books, we come back with numbers that are reduced, and we're end up in the same spot every February. So can you talk about that?
Yes. 90% of our issues is charter schools, because we assumed that amount would come in about $36 million when I costed everything out. But because the per pupil cost increased, they went up to $37.5, which was a shock to everyone. Foundation, I thought they would be at about 800 students, but they have 988. because they increase, even though they increase K through 12, they also increase in the number of classrooms that they will have for 16-17. So we know that no new charter schools will be coming in, but the expansion piece is what we're wrestling with, because STEM will have 12th grade in 17-18. Well, that's over $1 million itself. That's 100 students at about 12,000 per student. So that will be $1 million too, without looking at the other schools who may expand. Pace is also a situation that's always an adjustment, because they take students from Hamilton and Trenton. So a lot of times I'll put 50-50, and then they'll get 90% from Trenton and 10% from Hamilton. So I have to go back and adjust our budgets. That's why it's very important on the October 15th count that not that the kids have to be in the seats, they have to be enrolled in our school district so we can receive that funding. Instead of a charter school, we're going back and forth with choice or charter or non-public about conflict claiming students.
Ms. Howard, we know that those numbers come down twice a year, right? For the charter schools, or the our enrollment numbers, right?
Yes.
And so, what conversations have you had to have with the different stakeholders to determine why these numbers are going up?
Well, our number one stakeholder is the state, because they give us the information. And many times during our October 15 count, I said, okay, I'm claiming the students, so it's a charter school. I said, but they don't have all of their paperwork in order, which means if I don't have the proper registration documents, I won't be paid for the student. Well, neither will they. So in 15-16, we were able to get some relief from that because we fought them on their paperwork. But I knew in 16-17 that they were claiming students because they would make sure that they had the proper documentation. Now, for some reason, and Les and I keep going back and forth with the state, and he's even talking to the state about this topic, why are you always underestimating the charters, because you give us the numbers, you download it, you tell me what the budget. So after I budget that, and then you come up in October and say, oh, by the way, it's $1 million difference, then I'm running around trying to find $1 million. But what I don't understand is if I do that, I'm held accountable, but the state, there's no accountability. So that's a big part of our issue, because there's nothing I can do about the state saying, oh, by the way, they have 17 more students. Because the charters, although it's not allowable, they have waiting lists. So if five of our students leave, I know they're going to call five more students off the list. So that's why there's never any relief for the school district, because as soon as five come back, then five more leave. And they're also allowed to participate in our music program and in our sports program. But I have to transport these students back and forth. So it's just a lot of revenue and expenses that go out the door that we're really trying to analyze a little deeper, and we're meeting with the state and with Les to see how can we change this.
I think one of the things that I heard in your presentation in reference to the question that I asked originally about the overall process is the review by not only the principals, which are leadership within our school leaders and the school leadership team, school-based budgets were presented, I think it was the last page of the slide, but also central office review, as well as union partner review, and a community presentation for comments and input in the overall budget process. And at the county level, we actually presented a preliminary budget to the county on March 8th. And that was another process of review, dialogue, communication, reduction, potentially, or whatever adjustment were made at the county level before it came to the board at this point where we are tonight. And also, I wanted to just reiterate what you said, just to kind of, so I understand the overall process as well, is that we actually started with a $12 million shortfall back in August or so, and then we got down to about 10 and 5, but we actually got down to about roughly a $5.9 million shortfall, which is roughly $6 million difference in our favor. So essentially, this budget could be a lot worse. consistent national efforts are revealing at the principal level, school-based, they did a great job, central office doing their job, union partners being involved, the community being involved to get us to this point. So I just want to make sure that that's what I'm hearing that you're saying. Also, I just want to just ask one more question, maybe a couple more questions after this particular question. But I want to understand more about the efforts that we're putting for next year. Not without regard necessarily to charter schools, but how we're addressing long-term costs, limiting our long-term costs, where we have year after year costs rising, rather than focusing on one-time acquisitions and not putting ourselves in a position where if we do decide to bring in a program or new item for approval, and that's not something that will jeopardize our budget shortfalls going forward. How are we addressing those things?
The way you address that is, as I spoke about, I think it was 3 or 4 years ago, when we received the additional $16 million because we had about 3 or 4 charter schools to close at that time. And I said, you can't bring in people because you can't sustain the salaries. So now we're 3 years down the road, and we're saying with that $4 million that we have, and I showed you an excess surplus, we have to look at that because that piece will go away. See, the key is the excess surplus. When a new governor comes in, because when Christie came in 3 or 4 years ago, he took away all excess surplus from every school budget. At the time, we were lucky because we didn't have excess surplus. Well, now we do. And it could be $3 million. So we knew a new governor's going to wipe that out. So we need to look at what is our budget. It's the state amount, which is $229 million, plus grants, but they're restricted. Grants, which is $41 million, and then the $21 million we receive from the city. At this time, we have to live within that budget because prior to 2008, there was a mechanism for you to go out and get supplemental funding if you show that, okay, these students need X, Y, and Z. But after 10 years of research and looking at test scores and data, when they put this funding formula in place and they expanded on the word needy, which is saying we have other school districts besides the 31 avid districts who need additional funding, and now it's one size fits all. It's like you having 3 children and you take them to the store and get the same size shoe. Well, that's where we are. So we have to look at that and say, we have to live within our means at this point until we receive another funding formula. And whoever's voting for the funding formula needs to understand how they're voting, because it really hurt your former avid districts. Because I can't control the money that we receive. But I have to make sure that I balance the budget, because I can't give the county superintendent an unbalanced budget. It will come out as a fatal error, and we will receive zero instead of receiving what we receive. So we're looking at that for 17-18. How do we live within the state funding, our city funding, and our grants without looking at excess surplus? And that will be a one-time purchase of something that we need, so we won't have to worry about 3 years out trying to sustain that cost. And that's what we didn't do 3 or 4 years prior.
Right, so what I'm hearing is that it's going to be challenging for us to introduce new programs in the district that would, in fact, increase our cost, not only in this next year's budget, but also in 17-18 going forward. So we have to be very mindful extending additional programs that may cost us more money, whether it be staff or whether it be other programs. So we have to live within our means and really monitor and fine-tune the programs we currently have in the district in order to move our district forward.
We evaluate the programs that we currently have, and if they're not working, and the data shows that, then you discontinue and then you bring in the program. So we need to also do that. Look at all of our programs and evaluate them.
You mentioned earlier that about 90% of our deficit is due to charter schools. And I saw an increase of 6%, and correct me if I'm wrong, but you said said that about 500 children are leaving next year?
Between charter choice and non-public.
Correct. So that will be payments that we have to allocate for them as well. But you also said that you're going to do everything that you can not to have a deficit next year.
We don't have a deficit currently. We have a shortfall. That's the difference.
Shortfall. Can you just elaborate on that?
Yes, a deficit is your revenues and your expenses don't equal. Our revenue and expenses equal, but we have a shortfall because we have so much money going out, which is out of district charter schools. So we receive the money in. It's just that our kids are going out, so the money is following our students out the door. That's a shortfall. A deficit is that you cannot meet your expenses.
I understand, but what is the plan not to have a shortfall next year?
The plan is what I described to Mr. Trueheart earlier, is to see, number one, how can we keep our students in district? That's number one, okay? That's our biggest issue. Number two is to look at our programs, evaluate our programs for efficiency, to say, okay, should we keep it, should we not keep it, and make sure every school and every department is operating efficiently. You know that as a department head. I know my department is not operating efficiently. You can see your waste, and we need to make sure, and then after we look at that, then we have to say, this is our budget, not with excess surplus, because if a new governor comes in, as I stated earlier, there's no guarantee that we'll be able to keep that. So then we need to try to keep those costs. So now we're looking at our 16-17 budget within just our state funding and our city funding and the grants. And we're trying to see how can we make it to June without looking at the excess surplus. So we're already working on that exercise. And from there, then we'll be able to maintain. Now remember, our other issues are, if we budget, because whether we have, I know we can't talk about negotiations, but whether we have contracts that are ratified or not, I still have to make sure that I encumber funds. So if I encumber a certain amount, and then the board decides to give a different amount, then that's also, that could be a shortfall. So that's why there's a lot of discussions that have to take place in order for the budget to be efficient. Not just from my end, it has to be across the board for the board, leadership, at the school level, so we can make sure that we're all on the same page.
So I'm hearing is that, I'm just going to create what I'm hearing. So, number one, we have to keep our schools in district. And regarding that, what are some of the, strategies that we're thinking about for next year and beyond to keep our schools in district?
I really think we need to really be aggressive and have a marketing plan that really engages everyone, showcasing all of the positive things that are going on in our schools. I mean, 3 years ago, we didn't have a robust arts and music program. Mm-hmm. Now we do. And so marketing what's going on in our schools multiple ways. Athletics is another example. We did not have sports in the middle school a couple of years ago. We now do have. I think we really definitely need to market our product, market what is happening, marketing the progress, showcasing that there is a graduation rate increase. But we need to be really aggressive at the school level, at the district level, at the community level, marketing our product.
I think that's important, but how do we do that? How do we go about doing that?
I mean, I think we can do that multiple ways. I mean, through community events, through our website, through our literature, through at the school level, our parent roundtables, embracing all of our families, open houses at the schools, showing what does exist. Recently, we had a parent who had doubts about coming to one of our schools. We asked that parent, go to the school, give us a chance.
Okay, so yes, the scores don't look that high. However, these are all the other items that are going on in that school that are relevant, that are fun, that I'm sure your child will enjoy. And a parent went to the school, was highly impressed at the school, and that's just one example of the things we can do to really market our schools.
I just had a couple of questions. One was to do with the $6 million gap in transportation aid that you talked about. Are there any strategies that we can employ to try to address that gap?
Yeah, I've been working with many of my departments on our transportation needs and struggles. One plan that we put in place, a marketing plan, we met with all of our charter schools, non-public, and our in-district schools to say, have the documentation to us on time. The documentation is late, that's $200 more. Because remember, they're outsourced. So Hamilton, Ewing, everyone else uses the same buses. So if I wait to the last minute, then instead of paying $200, I'm paying $400 or $500. So that's one plan we have in place. Also, we have to look at decreasing the number of students that receive courtesy busing. Because the state pays us for our regular ed students that are remote, our special ed students that are remote. Now within that, they look at the average cost, which means they look at from home to school. Now if I'm riding somebody who lives across the street or around the corner to school, then they put that as a negative and say they can walk, whether they're regular ed or special ed. So they don't fund us 100% of everyone that's remote. They look at the home to school piece too, because Trenton is 7.5 miles. So we're transporting everyone, and the students are late for school because how can all the buses get through Trenton at 7.5 miles as I'm transporting so many students? Like, so we're looking at that, and a lot of times I ride behind the school bus. Parents will come to board meetings, oh, well, my child wasn't picked up to make sure they're at the correct stops, and that they're outside because you can't blow the horn. So we're also looking at that, and we, overall, our charter school busing is a little is not as unstable as our in-district busing. And that's with for all departments. So we've been working with our assistant superintendent for special ed to make sure we have the numbers on time, ESY on time, because a lot of times she's waiting on information also, so we can cut our costs down. Because we know they give us $2.9 million. They don't care how much you spend. This is what you're going to receive. If you want to spend $6 or $7 million, then where's the money coming from? Our students. So we are looking at that. And then we're also trying to see whether we should bring more buses in-house. Mm-hmm. And then maybe we can bring on bus drivers and see if we can be more efficient that way. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at a lot of different options for busing.
Thank you. My other question is really more of a comment, is just what you noted about our special education students and the percentage that we get back of the 14.71% versus the actual percentage that we have, which is closer to 19 or 20%. And that just seems really inequitable. It seems like something we should all be advocating for that to be a fair percentage.
Thank you.
The first public speaker is Ms. Betty Lund. Ms. Lund, you have 10 minutes.
Good evening, board members. For those who do not know me, my name is Betty Glenn, and I am president of the Trenton Paraprofessionals Association. I didn't have enough time to write a speech today because I found out this afternoon the number of percentage that my members were going to be looked out for the news. So I'm going to speak from my heart. And I'm speaking to you, and I'm coming before you today to let you know that the paraprofessionals, many of them are your parents. Many of all of them, just about, live here in this city. When You ask for a lot of special things to go on in this district. I always say yes, and we're always there. When it comes to the children, and you're saying privatize, I'm going to hold you on that because as I when I met you, Ms. Rosamond, a few years ago, and we talked about privatization, I remember your words, quote, unquote, it does not work. And it doesn't work. You brought in the one-on-ones, and they're scandalous. It's horrible the way they are. Our children are not being serviced by them. They don't come in. When they do come, they're on the phones. You're going to tell me that you're going to get 92 paraprofessionals by September, and I'm going to bet my life, my son's life, that it won't happen. If these teachers are going to be in these classes with autism children, with no training, that you're just going to hire these people to come in and have them support our teachers, which they have no idea what they can, what are they getting in for. You're taking the special ed department, and we have our special ed department because many of the charter schools don't take our special ed kids. The children that they take from us are some of our better children. But you know why they're taking them from us? Because of exactly what you're doing now. You're not keeping these schools, our schools, with the adequate personnel that we need in these schools. Every year, we're going to go through the same thing. It's going to come up to where you're going to say, well, the charter school took some more children. Yes, they are, because look what you're taking from them now. As a parent, and I have a child in a special ed class, as a parent, do you think I want you to just send any old person in there? These people have been with these children, they know their children, and some of them are their children that are attending these schools. When you come to parent involvement, the paraprofessionals are always there, bringing in parents, bringing in things to this district. We have been here, we live here, we're going to fight you every way we can to stay here. And I understand, I know that you can vote yes. But don't vote yes if your heart's not in it. And you can't have your heart in this knowing that these people do not come and bring the best foot forward for our students. I'm asking you to take a stand. Stand up and fight with us and say no to the state. Stand up and say to the state, these are our kids, and we're not going to let them down because of some numbers that you're portraying to us. I'm asking you to stand up and stand with us and fight back with the state for once. I remember our old superintendent, Dr. Lytle. He used to say the state was on crack because they were treating our children any kind of way. And he would tell us, and he fought for our children.
Yes, he did.
He fought every mean, every bone in his body. Asking you, Interim Superintendent Lucy Pereira, to stand up with us. Fight for our kids. Stand up and tell the state no. Just tell them that we're not going to let you do any more damage to our children's mind. And I'm asking this district, I'm asking the board members who live here in this city, who live here, that just live here to stand up with us because we live here with you. And every time that you take and reduce staff in this city, you're reducing our city. It's never going to be a city that it can be as long as you continue to down it and to reduce our staff in this city. I'm asking you today to vote from your heart, not with your mind, to vote from your heart and just say no.
And make an educated and wise decision.
which favors and enhances the education of the children in Trenton, not reduces services to the most needy. Approximately 16 child-related service positions are slated for privatization. By eliminating the related service positions, services will be disrupted to children across the district. Each related service specialist is currently servicing caseloads between 55 and 65 students. These services are taking place in 21 of the district schools. This is about 400 to 600 related service sessions a month. In this group of specialists, we have two bilingual related service specialists, which took about 15 years for us to get. Privatizing these related therapy positions will disrupt approximately 10,800 service sessions to the students of Trenton, who are primarily attending elementary schools during the time of their critical and formative years. These sessions include services which were rendered to the preschool disabled classes, the general ed, eligible for speech language services, all special education classes, including our specialized classes, which are the autistic children and the like. These 10,800 service sessions have already been written in their IEPs for the upcoming school year. Question: who will deliver the services of 16 full-time related therapists and the to the children if these positions are privatized? Because of the widespread geography of the district and the sheer volume of service numbers, it will be impossible for a private agency to supply enough related services to absorb the entire caseloads of 16 full-time related services specialists and provide adequate renderings of the mandated services for these children. Are you aware that there is a national shortage of speech-language specialists?
Yes.
Therefore, what you currently have in the district is irreplaceable. Even if a reduction in state aid occurs, special ed is protected by law. These services must be funded. Questions: do you actually know how many therapists you can get from an agency when there is a national shortage of speech-language specialists? Do the people that you bring from these agencies know the procedures here in the district in order to for the related services to maintain compliance? I assure you they do not. Because we, the district therapists, are the ones who are showing them what to do. The administrators aren't sufficiently aware of the kind of paperwork that they have to do, and they can't provide the detailed instruction on how to do that. They ask us to do that.
That's right.
In recent years, Trenton Public Schools have been out of compliance with state regulations concerning services to children. If these related therapy positions were eliminated, the district would immediately be out of compliance once again, and without necessary manpower to will be needed to satisfy the state and federal regulations. Do you know that that this year we have gotten three speech language pathologists from agencies, and at max they all have no more than 25 children on their caseload? The district speech therapists have an average of 55 on their caseload, and we're doing it flawlessly. When they are asked to take on more, they say they can't do it, and they can't handle the children. So they're not going to be able to do what we can do.
That's right.
Do you, what quality of the services will these children be able to get? Because agencies have no vested interest in our children. I was asked to contact one of the agency people to basically convince her to come and help us out. And at the end of my conversation with her, she asked, well, what about the neighborhood? I went through the neighborhood and I just didn't feel safe. This was Stokes School, which is about as suburban as it gets in Trenton. Okay, they don't want to come here. They're from the suburbs, they're not used to our children, and it's not in their interest, and if they don't like it, they leave. Related service personnel are required to log in time-consuming records of attendance, which is the therapy sessions that we provide for each child serviced into Easy IEP on a monthly basis. This is approximately 440 to 600 services logged monthly. These numbers are converted to Medicaid dollars for the district. The district is reimbursed based on our salaries as well as our benefits. Therefore, we generate revenue for this district. No other positions in the district do this.
Ms. Finley, please respond to your remarks.
Okay. SEMI is also reimburses for transportation based on the students receiving related services, which again generates revenue for the district. In addition, the SEMI monies, the district also receives federal dollars for each eligible student classified under special ed law. Furthermore, I'd like to state that in the New Jersey Code, it states that the
Finish.
Okay.
We have other people that are here speaking.
Okay. All right. Speech language services can be they can use private agencies only if they cannot find speech language pathologists to do the job, not just eliminate the entire department. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Ben Kenny, and I'm one of the occupational therapists in the district. Before we started, I saw on the slide, and I see it on the website, it said, children come first. So I wanted to just put that in your mind before I start and go through my speech. Also, there were things that came up tonight that I heard about a plan to keep students in the district. I have many, many parents that leave the district for whatever reason, and they come back. And they ask for the services again because they have not received the occupational therapy, the speech therapy, the physical therapy that they should have received in their out-of-district schools or charter schools. And one of the reasons they come back is to receive those services from the providers here in the district. We've all been here upwards of 17 years. We know our students, we know our parents, and we know the teachers. Building a rapport is probably the most important part of therapy. If the students don't know us, if they don't trust us, if the parents don't know us, if they don't know how to reach us in the evenings, on the weekends sometimes, we're not going to have their support, and we're not going to be able to positively affect those children. Tiffany talked about all the money and the laws. They all apply to us as well. So I'm not going to reiterate it. But I will say that every year since I've been here, the district has tried to supplement our services with contractors. And every year, the contractors stay 3 months, 2 months. They leave. And they leave those children not receiving services until the district can locate another therapist. And in most cases, it never happens. This year alone, with the Kaleidoscope Contracting Company, we had a therapist servicing children. She disappeared after 3-4 months, not leaving her work, not leaving her evaluations, not having billed for her services. Is that the kind of service that we want to provide to our students? Is that what we want our parents to see when they decide what school to send their special needs children? Trenton is very fortunate to have the quality of therapists that we have. I have not had the chance to work with any of you, but I have had the chance to work with all our teachers and our parents, and I think they would attest to the quality that we provide to these students. We often stay till 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock for meetings to accommodate parents, and we don't bill for it. We did over 150 evaluations last year. A contracting rate for that could run up to $700 per evaluation. That doesn't include travel time for the therapist. That doesn't include their lunch break for the therapist. We do this on our own. We do this as part of our job, as part of our mission here. I will. So, contract therapists will bill for every minute of their time.
They will bill for their travel time. They will bill for their documentation time. They will bill for their evaluation time. They will bill for how many students they see per hour. These are things that I hope that you will all take into consideration when you make these very important decisions. And as Tiffany said, we are in demand, and it is almost impossible to find a therapist. I know you're in a, we're in a hurry. So, being that said, I will conclude my remarks.
Before I leave the podium, I just want to read the school code of ethics. for board members. It says, I will uphold and enforce all laws, rules, and regulations of the State Board of Education and court orders pertaining to schools. Desired changes shall be brought about only through legal and ethical procedures. So, when you take your vote this evening, I hope that you will follow the School Ethics Act. And I also hope that those of you that have a professional responsibility to do the right thing will do the right thing tonight. Mm-hmm. And after this board meeting, when you decide to take your vote, we're going to take a look and see who voted for what. So I hope your vote is in accordance with the law tonight. And we need to keep our paraprofessionals.
Come on.
We need to keep our teachers.
Come on.
And we need to keep our special education and related services teachers.
Pan out
I'm most disturbed by that. It's inexcusable that people on the leadership team can leak information to people without the union presidents even being aware.
That's right.
It's inexcusable. In this district, since 2001, the jobs of cafeteria workers, security guards, one-on-one paraprofessionals have all been privatized. And we know that the quality of the service has decreased. These are all employees, almost 100% of them live in the city of Trenton.
That's right.
Now you want to privatize and outsource some more. Speech teachers, occupational therapists, physical therapists, paraprofessionals who work with our students with the greatest need. Our students with disabilities. So yes, this budget is discriminatory at its very nature.
Yes.
I can't forget and leave out school counselors because they work with some of our students who work with some mental issues, instabilities, trauma. How can you cut this? And we have children who are in crisis each and every day. Now, all of you live in Trenton. That's why you're serving on this board. Obviously, the state manager, Les Richens, and the county superintendent, Laura Morano, and probably some others at DOE are advocating for these large scale layoffs. And they want it done through outsourcing. They want it to be done through privatization because they say we know that can save dollars. They don't care that it's increasing the unemployment rate in the city of Trenton, which already hovers around 25%. They don't care. They don't care because they're already getting a big pension and they get a huge salary on top of that. So they don't care. But you live here, and all of you should care. Because when you say yes to this budget, what you're actually going to do is tell your neighbors that you belong on an unemployment line.
That's right.
You should vote no on this budget until the leadership sits down with the union heads so that we can find alternatives to privatizing and outsourcing jobs.
Yes.
Your plan is to cut 3 child study teams. Well, I'm going to tell you, some of you on this board are pretty new. It might be your first time hearing it. It's not mine. I heard it in 2011 when they cut us down to 10 teams. And what did they have to do?
Bring them back.
Because the number of students with IEPs did not decrease. Already, our members have 65, you heard the caseload. In private companies, they might walk around with 25 or 30. So you reduce us by 9 people, you're gonna get 18 of them. What's the true cost analysis? So as I said, this isn't the first time I've heard it.
because this is the state's plan. So Lex, you're just carrying the baton.
Which he is.
I guess you want to do it well. Because this started with Mark Cowan.
Yes, it did. Yes, it did.
Because his plan was to bring back students into the district, lay off child study team workers, and then increase the caseload. Kind of asinine. Did he even care about our students?
No.
So now, if you want to cut them down to 10 teams, Les and Liz, you're saying 250 cases per team. How ridiculous is that? Tell our poor little black and brown children that you don't care about them. Make it clear. Because you know what it sounds like to me? Institutional racism. These cuts are outrageous and demands that you want to leave or give to those who are left behind are almost humanly impossible. You know, I'm looking at my speech pathologist. You're talking about 9 educators with about 175 years of experience combined. They've given of themselves in great service to this Trenton Public School District. They have between 17 and 30 years of experience each. So you said they won't talk, let's not worry about the person. They are people. Layoffs wreck lives.
Yes, they do.
These people have given their lives to service the children of Trenton for 17 to 30 years. I'm at 17 years waiting to get 25 so that my pension is intact.
Right.
And you're going to tell me to go work for some private company for peanuts? And I'm supposed to take it laying down? I don't think so. And I'm appalled that you would want that to be the order of business. You see, as I mentioned, institutional racism, it comes a time when each of you are going to have to assess yourselves internally. You say you're here to service this community,
and you're not.
But yet you pump into the state.
Yes, you did.
When are you going to get some spine, some backbone? Oppressing our children.
Right.
Let it be them, not us.
Right.
We all know that these people have more experience than you'll get from any agency.
That's right.
We know that. The quality of work is going to be better for our children from these workers than from new people right out of college with no experience working for an agency. Why is it okay to say that less than is okay for our children?
That's right.
Our children are not for sale.
That's right.
This is inexcusable.
Yes, it is.
We should not just accept this year after year after year after year. We're waiting for you as a board
to
be a voice for the children of Trenton.
Yes.
did her presentation. Again, I heard 21 million, but it just went from 21.1 to 21.5. When will this district ever, this city ever be able to pay its fair share to this district if you keep laying off all the workers? Because you see, they won't be able to pay a mortgage. They lose their home, they can't pay the taxes on it. And you won't even be getting 21 million. Where's the logic in that? I'm just going to ask for the last time this evening, do the right thing. Vote no to this budget.
Yes.
And let's try to move this district forward and stop accepting this state and its efforts to push us backwards.
That's right.
Thank you.
Return to the public school system, which academic performance and high expenditures. I wanted to read that because the reason why we continue to be in this position over and over again is because we as urban schools have not banded together as one to fight the dismantling and destroying of the public education system. That is simply where we are. I'm here on a daily basis when the children do return back from Trenton High School, the horrible treatment they receive when they are told they must leave. But here's one thing that I can guarantee you that is true. It is spring. And with the spring comes the spring park. And what we know is that with spring park, these charter schools will soon park these students back on our doorstep.
Going to be if he was the part
taking place here tonight. I need to know that because you've seen this budget before, you've seen the proposed cuts, you report back to him. So now I'm suspect that we didn't get a return call because he may be aware of the reductions that you're going to be voting on tonight. And if he has not seen them and he just saw them for the first time today, he should be calling each and every one of you in here for creating a disturbance in the community of which he was elected to oversee. And I'm going to ask him, again to review why members are being appointed to this Board of Education that are not taking that vital and critical information to him as the mayor of this city. So, Gerald, when you review committees of people who review the budget, as if you're saying, oh, all of these people have the opportunity to sit down and engage in conversation, do not leave yourselves out as you determined where the cuts were going to come from and have input. Your hands are just as dirty also.
Months
When we met, we asked the open-ended question of all the presidents of the unions. We said, this is where we are. We have a shortfall. What are some of the recommendations? And the response was, that's what you get paid for. You're the leadership. So we took that very seriously and went back to work in the numbers.
We don't have anything to give.
To give, that's correct. You're absolutely accurate. We don't have anything to give. That is accurate. We went around person by person, and everyone said, the bottom line is that it's going to end up being people.
Just want to say that.
Do I consider this to be a racist budget? Discriminatory was the term that was used. If I believed that it was discriminatory, I would not have engaged in it. There are cuts across lots of units. The mechanics just went from having 42 several years ago, 6-7 years ago, to now having 12. There was a large impact there. The custodians went from...
We stayed custodians.
Correct, but they still, no, not completely, because they still lost 20 positions last year. And they are overworked, they're tired. They work very long hours trying to make up for the less, you know, for less people. That is true. And so, discriminatory, I would not say it's discriminatory. Difficult, yes. Is lots of city residents, I'm sure. Could we make up for the expertise of some of the people that are in the room right now? I don't know. Do you believe that for a moment, I wanted to hurt any of you? Absolutely not. Do you think for a moment I wanted to hurt our kids? I will tell you, absolutely not. I was responding to the question by our board member. He asked me a question and I was responding.
Mr. President, I cannot believe that what we are doing here would come to that. Well, it's a racist budget. It is a ridiculous idea to say that.
No.
Let me tell you this.
Quiet.
Let me tell you this. Excuse me, it's my turn to speak now. I respect yours, you respect mine. Thank you. I've worked so hard to be a resident of the city of Trenton. I love this city. Yes, I'm an immigrant. I came here when I was 15 years old. But let me tell you what this city has been to me. And it has been a city of opportunity. A city where I've been able to work, to rent a house, then to buy a house. A city where I know it has a host of issues. But I know how I was raised, and I was raised with a profound interest and obligation to civic duty. And I come to a lot of these meetings where, by the way, is 100% volunteer work. For those of you who come onto this mic and say that for somehow there is another type of interest. And a lot of these meetings, we face the disrespect from people that we expected the least. Meeting after meeting. Now, one of the things that I value the most is the First Amendment of the Constitution, and it's the freedom of speech. I will defend to death your right to say whatever you want to say. But don't come up here and say or try to intimidate me into not voting for something that I know needs to be done. That I know that I am going to do, and I will vote for this budget, yes. Because it needs to be done. If we really want to move forward as a city, as a united city, we need to continue to make the tough decisions. And guess what? Tomorrow, what the newspaper is going to say is some of those ridiculous things that were said here today, but not. It's not going to talk about the positive trends and about the good things that are happening in our district. Like what?
Yes.
Mr. President, I yield back my time. Thank you.
Jason Redd.
As I pledge my vote here, nobody, this is not a vote that anybody wants to take here.
and it's not something that we take lightly because we recognize what this vote entails. But we have a fiduciary responsibility to vote on a balanced budget. So that is what our requirement is, we have to vote on a balanced budget. It doesn't mean that the work stops here. I would hope that the folks who didn't have enough courtesy to wait for our vote will at least go down to the State House and will continue to advocate down there. What's going on currently before the budget committees of both respective houses is that different school districts are down there lobbying for additional money within the budget. We have to work within the dollars that we were given. I think this is probably the third budget I've had to vote for that includes a cut. I know that these cuts include my neighbors, they include folks who are my friends. This is not a vote that we take lightly. And I think that it's irresponsible for the leadership of the groups that spoke up and called the members of this board doing these things for self-serving reasons. These folks serve here out of their time, and they look at not the cuts that are good versus bad, they're the bad that are worse. So I think it's irresponsible for them to call and claim any ulterior motive to the members that are up here. Their one motive is to provide the best education to the kids within this district. This isn't an easy vote. This isn't anything that we take lightly. It's not. We recognize the value that our staff provides to the kids within this district, and we recognize the fact that making these decisions means that our kids will have to go without. They'll have to go without the talented individuals that we're unable to keep within the district. But if we are unable to do this, if we took a vote and gave away our duty as a board to vote for a balanced budget, all that means is we can't regulate ourselves and we are one step closer to state takeover. Now, who does that serve? That doesn't serve the residents of the city of Trenton to have the Board of Education come in here, but if we gave away the power to vote on a balanced budget that included tough choices, then that is the next step, and don't think that is not. State takeover is the next step. If Les Richens goes back to Commissioner Heskey and says, they can't govern themselves, I had to step in, and I had to make the tough choices, the next step is, you don't need us up here, you just need a state monitor. Look to North, look to Patterson, and see how successful that is. So, while it is a tough choice, and while it is a vote that I do not want to take, it is the fiduciary responsibility that I have been tasked with as a board member and as a president of this board. So I regretfully vote yes, but it's better than the vote no, and it's a vote for takeover, because that's exactly what it is, and don't believe anything else you hear. A vote not to take the responsibility we're due is an invitation to the state to take over this district.
Jane Rosenau?
Yes.
I'll say that Jane passed.
I'll entertain a motion to enter into executive session.
So moved.
Second.
Before you go, I just want to say something. Was it too late?
And you withdraw the motion to enter into executive
session? I withdraw the motion.
I would just like to say that I'm glad Jason said
this. Your mic on.
I'm glad that Jason said what he said, because he said it better than I could have. This is not a vote that I've made happily. I don't want a state takeover. And it's not something that's going to be solved by the members on this board. It's something that the voters are going to have to do. And you have to advocate for our education.
If I may add, I do concur. We are not a board that wants to be in a position where hard decisions have to be made. But one thing you do see us here, we're here in unity as a board, making the proper decisions for the Board of Education to move us forward. And I have to be honest, to sit in a meeting and see leadership walking out of a building when we're trying to make the right decisions, I've never seen this before in all my years of my professional life. And I have to say, it's not the best. I don't even know. I'm lost for words at this point to see that we have leadership that's governing our unions to walk out of a meeting when all we're doing is coming together to make the right decisions for the Board of Education.
I'll entertain a motion to the exec session.
So moved.
Second. Whereas the Oklahoma Meetings Act codified at NJSA 10:4-6 permits the exclusion of the public from a meeting under certain circumstances, and whereas the Trent Board of Education is of the opinion that such circumstances presently exist, indicated as follows: any pending or anticipated litigation or contract negotiation. Association, and the proposed settlement agreements with DEO, MB, and CG. Now therefore be it resolved by the Board of Education, County of Mercer, State of New Jersey, that an executive session be held on Monday, March 21st, 2016, for the statutory permissible purposes indicated in this resolution. Be it further resolved that action may be taken once the board reconvenes in an open session. Be it finally resolved that the executive session with regards to the above subject matter shall be disclosed to the public at a later date, to the extent that the same is not prejudicial to any of the interests or parties involved, no longer adverse to the public interest, or does not endanger any individual's rights to privacy. I'll entertain a roll call.
D.A. Grant?
Yes.
Thea Gussie?
Yes.
Denise Millington absent. Jane Rosenbaum?
Yes.
Guillermo Gomez?
Yes.
Joe Schuhart?
Yes.
Lucy Vandenberg?
Yes.
Jason Redd?
Yes. We're in session.